So thanks very much. It's wonderful to be here. I'm a little bit intimidated because we've had all these wonderful industry and technical talks, but I'm going to have to bring us way down the TRL ladder because I'm going to talk to you about stuff that was done, shock horror, in a university lab. Okay, so this is a little bit back, but I'm trying, what I want to do is show you the sort of things that we can do. So my name is Jonathan Coleman. I'm from Trinity College, Dublin. We're an old university, but I work in the Nanoscience Center, and it's quite interesting because it's an industry-facing nanoscience center. We have to work with industry. So we have to both do excellent basic research and applied industrial research. So that's quite hard to balance those things. So my own research is mostly in two-dimensional materials. So I started off in the late 90s working with carbon nanotubes. But about 10 years ago, we started making graphene. And in fact, the process that we invented 10 years ago is now, or descendants from it, is now responsible for 65% of the world graphene production. But I don't want to talk about graphene. One of the things about our graphene method is that you can make it in liquids. And if you can make stuff in liquids, that gives you a very broad capability. And over a decade ago, we realized that one of the things that we could do was mix materials like graphene with carbon nanotubes. And that gives you a sort of broad functionality that you wouldn't get with any one material. And in particular, these sort of mixtures of different types of nanomaterials with carbon nanotubes are wonderful for applications in energy. So we call these mixtures nano-nanocomposites, and this is an example of a mixture of carbon nanotubes and tungsten disulfide nanosheets. It's just a type of 2D material. And in this particular case, what the nanotubes do is they create conductive paths within that nanomaterial. And we can control the conductivity by 9 orders of magnitude just by controlling the amount of nanotubes. Now, that's important for a range of applications, including batteries. Anyone who works with batteries knows that typically you have to add a conducting additive such as carbon black. And nowadays, more and more, we're seeing carbon nanotubes being added to battery electrodes to improve the conductivity. I want to show you an example of that before I move on to the main part of the talk. So molybdenum disulfide is a two-dimensional material that was first mooted for work in batteries in about 1980. There's a patent from Exxon, I think it is, from 1980. But in fact, although this material should be great for storing lithium, it's actually terrible. And this is data from my lab showing that the initial capacity is sort of okay, but with cycling, it dies completely. Now, the reason for that is it's not conductive enough. But if you add different amounts of carbon nanotubes, you increase the conductivity, and you dramatically increase the performance of these lithium-ion anodes. Now, there are two things going on here, and that's what I want to emphasize. First of all, the initial capacity in the first cycle increases as you add nanotubes because you're increasing the conductivity. Now, that's not rocket science. What's more interesting is that the stability of the electrode increases dramatically and goes through a very, very rapid increase around 1% nanotubes, and that's because of mechanics. So if you look into a failed electrode, you see that there is cracking from the charge discharge, from the expansion contraction cycles associated with charge discharge, but crucially, the nanotubes are bridging those cracks, holding the electrode together, and improving its functionality. So the first message I want to get across is nanotubes in batteries are not just for conductivity, they're also for mechanics. Now, can we use these nanotubes in real batteries? And many people have tried to do that, and many people are doing that in industry. Now, we're doing something a little bit different. What we want to do is using commercially available standard electrode materials, we want to replace the binder and the conductive additive with carbon nanotubes. So the carbon nanotubes are playing both an electrical and a mechanical role. And the ultimate goal here for us is to be able to make very thick electrodes which have very high areal capacity, but at the same time retaining their volumetric or specific capacity at as close to the theoretical level as possible. And it's been shown that if you can make very high areal capacity electrodes, then automatically you get very high volumetric energy density. So we want to see, can nanotubes achieve this goal, high areal capacity? So we want to improve both conductivity and mechanics. So conductivity, that's straightforward. It's just about moving charge around. But why is the mechanics important? Now, if anyone has ever been on holidays in somewhere where there's desert, will have seen something like this. This is mud cracking. And mud cracking happens when you have films deposited from solution, here mud from dry mud from wet mud, and you get drying, which if the film is above a certain thickness, leads to cracking. And there's something called the critical crack thickness, which limits the maximum thickness that you can make something from liquids. Now, you can increase the critical crack thickness by improving the mechanical properties of the material. So what we want to do is improve the mechanical properties of the battery electrode. That increases the critical crack thickness and will allow us to make very thick electrodes, which have high areal capacity, leading to very high energy densities. Okay, so it's a fairly straightforward hypothesis. So how are we going to do that? Well, we're going to use TUBALL nanotubes. They are really good for these sort of applications. One, because they make very, very conductive networks, and two, because they're nice and long, which give you very mechanically robust networks. And we found that this work was done in an industry project collaborating with Nokia, and we found that we could take virtually any lithium storage material, this is micron-sized silicon, and solution processing that lithium storage material with carbon nanotubes gives you a very unusual composite structure. It's called a segregated network, where the nanotubes form webs that wrap around the lithium storing particles. Now that means that both you get very good electrical connectivity, connection to the particles, but also fantastic mechanical properties. So let's look at that. This is mechanical data where you stretch the electrode, measure the applied force for different extensions, and you can make what are called stress strain curves. You see at the bottom left, way down near the origin, there's some orange data. Those are the mechanical properties of standard electrodes made with silicon and a polymeric binder. The other curves are segregated network electrodes where carbon nanotubes are reinforcing the material. These are all for silicon, and we get a dramatic increase in the mechanical properties. Now, the important mechanical property here is the tensile toughness, which is the area under the stress strain curve. And that toughness can be increased by four orders of magnitude by increasing the amount of nanotubes present. And it's known that it's that toughness, if you get that number up, you can increase the critical crack thickness and you can make very thick electrodes. Now, this was all for micron-sized silicon, but we did it for many, many other materials. And for example, on the left with NMC, and we find depending on the material we use, we can get a dramatic toughening effect with much, much less than 1% of TUBALL nanotube. So this is a very effective method of improving the properties of your electrode. Now, does this work? So on top, that is a standard electrode made from NMC mixed with a polymer binder and carbon black. The critical crack thickness of that electrode is 175 microns, and that picture is an attempt to make a 300 micron thick electrode, and you can see it is a complete failure. The electrode cracks immediately. That's no good. On the bottom, this is an electrode made from NMC with 1% TUBALL single-walled nanotubes. Here, this electrode is 800 microns thick and no sign of cracking. We have completely suppressed crack formation in these electrodes, which allows us to make electrodes at almost any thickness we like. This is a cross-sectional image of an 800 micron thick NMC anode. As far as I know, and I'm happy to be corrected on this, this is the thickest working battery electrode ever made. Now, the key word there is working. Do these work? So this is data for the areal capacity, the charge stored per unit area, as a function of the mass loading of the electrode. The red data is for anodes made from micron-sized silicon and carbon nanotubes. The black stars are data in the literature. Now, the areal capacity increases linearly with thickness, and that means that your entire electrode is working to its full potential. And most importantly, if we work out the specific capacity for these electrodes, we get within 95% of the theoretical capacity, even for electrodes that are in excess of 200 microns thick. We can do the same with cathodes, and we also find linear increase of areal capacity, and we find theoretical capacities for electrodes approaching 800 microns thick. And again, I don't think that's been demonstrated before. So once we have both cathodes and anodes, we can put those together to make full cells. And when we do that, we get almost the full performance that we would expect from the individual electrodes. So up here, we get full cells with areal capacities of approaching 30 milliampere per centimeter squared. These capacities are this high simply because we could make very thick electrodes. Finally, the energy density increases with the areal capacity. The black lines show what theory would protect. The black stars are our data for our nanotube-enabled full cells. You can see that we are matching the theoretic expectations, and we are getting energy densities that are larger, considerably larger than state-of-the-art. Values of 400 watt-hours per kilo, which we believe are pretty decent values. So I'm going to leave it at that. This is what we've done in the lab. This was done in our Amber Nanoscience Center, which is an industry-facing nanoscience center. The work was funded by Nokia Bell Labs and was patented, but because of the agreement that we have with Nokia, we have freedom to pursue this work independently with other interested parties. And I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Jonathan, thank you so much. Very nice presentation.